Welcome to the MOSOMIC MEMS Microphone Guide. In this episode, we continue going through my list of key value indicators for MEMS microphones. In this one, we talk about current consumption and the electrical robustness of MEMS microphones. Current consumption is the amount of current the microphone draws when operational. We'll talk about three different aspects of electrical robustness: power supply rejection, RF immunity, and ESD immunity. Stay tuned! This series is sponsored by Infineon Technologies. Hi, my name is Mikko Suvanto from MOSOMIC. Current consumption is a key capability indicator for MEMS microphones. There have been a lot of factors in recent years that have made it even more important than before. Always-on microphone systems are becoming ubiquitous. Such systems are, for example, speech-user interfaces and activity monitoring systems that require keeping one or more microphones operational constantly. Modern devices can easily include four or more microphones, so the consumption is multiplied if all microphones are used simultaneously. Improvements in the dynamic ranges of high-performance MEMS microphones have been significant in the last 10 years, like I mentioned in episode 8. The improvements in performance often come at the expense of current consumption. Limited battery capabilities in portable devices have made overall minimization of current consumption critical. I'll talk more about this in a minute. Current consumption is especially critical in very small battery-operated systems such as wearables and standalone Internet of Things devices. The operating time expectation with one small battery may be several years. The current consumptions of digital microphones are typically higher than the consumptions of analog microphones with similar performance. The difference is caused by the analog-to-digital conversion process. Digital microphones are used to improve the disturbance immunities of microphone systems. All these factors have made it even more important to keep a keen eye on the current consumptions of MEMS microphones. Device size restrictions and the limitations of battery technologies are severe limiting factors for the current consumption allowed for MEMS microphones. Manufacturers, naturally, want to make portable devices and the batteries in them as small as possible. The smaller the device is, for example a wearable, the smaller the battery is and the more critical current consumption is. Unfortunately, because of lacking advancements in battery technologies, small batteries lead to short device operating times. Smartphones are a good example of a device category where battery size and weight limitations have caused the battery capacities to be badly undersized, causing the need to charge the device at least daily or even twice a day if the device is used a lot. The most effective way to improve the operating times of devices is to reduce the current consumptions of all the components in them. This means also microphones, even though their consumption levels are relatively small as compared to some other components, for example displays. Even small reductions achieved in relatively small current consumers, like microphones, can add up to significant improvements. In bigger battery-operated systems, as well as in mains-powered systems, and also in other systems where current consumption is not limited, such as in motor vehicles, the current consumptions of MEMS microphones are not a great concern. In laptops, the current consumptions of microphones are less likely to cause significant reductions in device operating times, even if the microphones are constantly operational. Good examples of mains-powered devices are plugged-in digital assistants and smart speakers, as well as home appliances. The high current consumption of high-performance microphones can be avoided with the use of multiple operating modes. One mode can be a full-performance mode with maximized dynamic range. This mode is used when the device is in full operation and the best possible microphone performance is needed. Another mode can be optimized for always-on use, in which, naturally, current consumption is minimized. This is often called the low power mode. The reduction in consumption is typically achieved at the expense of the dynamic range. This means that the acoustic overload point is lower and/or the self-noise of the microphone is higher. Another parameter that may have to be compromised in low power mode is the width of the usable frequency range. In wirelessly connected devices, the source for operating current, the power supply, is rarely clean of disturbances. There are antennas, switching power amplifiers, switching regulators, charging systems, data buses, clock clients, other wireless devices, as well as many other disturbance sources that pollute the power supply. The disturbances can end up on the power supply line either by radiation, coupling from other signal lines, or as conducted disturbances that propagate galvanically in the device. Microphones must be designed so that the disturbances in the power supply don't turn into disturbances in the output of the microphone. The better the general noise performance of the microphone is, the more immune it should be to disturbances to prevent power supply noise from degrading signal quality. Factors that dictate the noise performance of a microphone are, for example, its self-noise and its RF immunity. We'll get into RF immunity in a minute. Power supply rejection, PSR, and power supply rejection ratio, PSRR, measure, like the names of the parameters say, how well a microphone rejects disturbances in its power supply input. In other words, PSR and PSRR tell us how well a microphone prevents the disturbances from reaching the information-bearing signal in the microphone. Power supply rejection is the output disturbance voltage level caused by a known test disturbance injected into the power supply voltage line. The unit of PSR is dBVA or dBFSA, decibels in relation to 1 volt, or, for digital output microphones, the full-scale digital signal. PSR is typically A-weighted, which means that the measurement results have been weighted to take into account how sensitive the human ear is to disturbances at different frequencies. Power supply rejection ratio is the ratio of a known test disturbance injected into the supply voltage of the microphone to the disturbance the test disturbance induces in the output of the microphone. The unit of PSRR is decibel. PSRR is only applicable to analog output microphones because the input disturbance and the output disturbance of a digital microphone are on different scales, dBV versus dBFS, and thereby the ratio cannot be directly calculated. PSR and PSRR are key parameters that indicate the electrical robustness of a microphone. Microphones face all kinds of electrical and electromagnetic conditions in the devices they are implemented in. The goal is that a device designer doesn't have to worry too much about the microphone. A good device designer will take the usual steps to do his or her best to make sure the power supply line is clean. She or he will make sure the circuit design is good, disturbances are filtered, layout is well designed, and so on. In many cases, the results of the device designer's efforts are not perfect, and that's when the electrical robustness of the microphone steps into picture, hopefully enabling clean microphone signals despite the shortcomings in the device design. High electrical robustness of a microphone can give a device designer and the device manufacturer some very tangible benefits. If the device design and execution and the power supply don't have to be perfect to enable achieving a clean microphone signal, the potential benefits can be, for example, better sound quality with no disturbances in the microphone signal, faster time to market because fewer design iterations are needed to optimize the device design, less need for disturbance filtering. Fewer filtering components means that less space is needed. Lower cost voltage supply because simpler power supply solutions and fewer components can be used. Lower system current consumption thanks to microphone power supply solutions that consume less power. If the power supply rejection performance of a microphone is high, the device designer can power the microphone with a compromised power source that is available in the device. If the PSI is not high enough, or if all available power sources are too dirty, the designer may have to create a clean supply from another, higher voltage source by using an LDO, a low dropout regulator. This can increase the current consumption of the microphone system significantly. There are many factors that affect the power supply rejection performance of a MEMS microphone. To improve the power supply rejection of a microphone, its designer must look at all the forms of disturbance propagation inside a microphone, including galvanic propagation and coupling over the air. The goal is to reject the disturbances, divert them to the ground, and thereby prevent them from reaching the sensitive microphone signals. The quality of the microphone grounding affects how efficiently the disturbances can be diverted to the ground. The design of the ASIC in the microphone affects how power supply disturbances are able to propagate from the power traces to other sensitive signals. Filtering, the attenuation or removal of disturbances, is important. It's important to keep the power supply lines and microphone information-bearing signals far away from each other to prevent disturbance coupling. The internal three-dimensional mechanical structure of the microphone package plays a key role in this. Naturally, it's also important to minimize the disturbances in the microphone's power supply input. Proper circuit design, high-quality ground, a regulated power supply, disturbance filtering, and proper device system layout help keep the power supply lines clean. I'll talk more about this in another episode where I talk about the electrical implementation of a microphone into a device. RF immunity is another important electrical robustness indicator for MEMS microphones. It tells us how immune a microphone is to radio frequency disturbances. RF disturbances can affect a microphone or a microphone system either as radiated interference or as disturbances that get conducted to the signal lines that run into and out of the microphone. Like I explained when I talked about power supply rejection, a modern wirelessly connected device contains a multitude of antennas and other disturbance sources. On the other hand, there can be four or more microphones in a device. This means in practice that it can be very challenging to avoid disturbance propagation from the noise sources into the key signal lines of the microphones. A high microphone RF immunity bears many of the same benefits as high power supply rejection performance. Better sound quality, faster time to market, less need for disturbance filtering, lower system cost, and so on. Any RF problems that may arise in a device can be especially tricky to resolve. Some people go as far as to describe the RF phenomena related to connected devices as black magic. In tangible terms, this can mean a lot of time and money spent by the device designer and the manufacturer on fixing problems. Therefore, high microphone RF immunity is very valuable to device manufacturers. There are many things that affect the radio frequency disturbance immunity of a microphone. The microphone package plays a key role in protecting the signals from disturbances. For this, a Faraday cage, a grounded box or cage, made out of a conductive material, is a key electrical phenomenon. A Faraday cage built into the microphone housing shields the microphone from radiated disturbances. I'll talk more about Faraday cages in a later episode. Disturbances can also be filtered out. Practically, filtering directs the RF energy into the ground of the device. Grounding is another key factor. All parts of the microphone, including the package, must be well grounded to enable directing disturbances to the ground of the device instead of them finding their way into the microphone signals. The circuitry and layout of the ASIC in a MEMS microphone play key roles also. A key thing to avoid is audible interference caused by demodulation of RF signals that reach the ASIC. The traces that can be affected by interference should be physically separated from the sensitive signals. Good power supply rejection performance is another key factor in the overall RF immunity of a microphone. A digital microphone interface is a great way to improve the RF immunity of a microphone system in a device. Digital signals are much more immune against disturbances than analog signals. Therefore, digital interface is favored in applications where there are lots of electrical and electromagnetic disturbance sources and/or the signal traces are long. For example, laptops use digital microphones practically exclusively. RF immunity can be specified and measured in many different ways. There are conducted RF tests, radiated RF tests, accessory-related tests, and so on. I'll talk about RF testing in more detail in a later episode about MEMS microphone testing. The third electrical robustness factor in this episode is ESD immunity. It describes how well a microphone withstands electrostatic discharges without being damaged. ESD immunity differs from power supply rejection and RF immunity because with ESD, we're not concerned about interference or disturbances during the exposure. The acoustic shock related to the discharge is typically so loud that any temporary audible disturbances don't matter. The key thing is that right after the shock, the microphone should immediately return back to normal operation with no lingering effects or permanent changes to its characteristics. Changes to be avoided are, for example, sensitivity drift or increase in noise. ESD shocks are caused by electrostatic voltage buildup that is an everyday occurrence when people move around and handle their electrical devices. Unlike most other sensitive electrical components inside an electrical device, MEMS microphones can be directly exposed to ESD sparks because of the air connection from the surface of the device all the way to the microphone. A spark can reach the microphone through the sound channel and hit the sensitive semiconductor systems inside the microphone. ESD can damage a MEMS microphone in two different ways. The first way is the high voltage spark that can damage the electrical circuits and components in the microphone. The voltage accumulated in a human body and clothes can be as high as 25 kilovolts. This may seem like an extremely high and dangerous voltage level, but the electrical current of an ESD spark is so small that humans are not in danger. However, for a semiconductor component, such as the ASIC in the microphone, the discharge can be deadly. Integrated circuits can be damaged by as low as 25 electrostatic volts. This is only 0.1% of the voltage possible in a discharge. The other way ESD can damage a MEMS microphone is that the pressure pulse caused by the spark damages the microphone mechanically. If the microphone sensor element is not robust enough to handle the pulse, the result can be immediate or latent damage. ESD performance can be specified and measured in different ways. For MEMS microphones, there are a few common standards that are followed. These standards describe test procedures to enable creating ESD events repeatably in a measurement laboratory. The standards define, for example, ranges, levels, test equipment, setups, procedures, calibrations, generator waveforms, and general uncertainties. A special ESD simulator gun is needed for the tests. The discharge strength is typically given as a voltage level in volts or kilovolts. Okay, that's it for this episode. In episode 10, we'll continue talking about MEMS microphone key value indicators. The topics on that one will be matching, stability, reliability, and robustness of MEMS microphones. I hope I'll see you around. Cheers! If you have any questions or comments, write them down in the comments below and I'll do my best to answer them. You can also contact me online or on social media. If you like what you saw here, give a like for the video and subscribe to the MOSOMIC channel. That way you help me reach more people and thereby create more content. If you need more in-depth microphone training than what you saw here, contact me and we can arrange it. The training can be adapted to suit any interests and skill levels, and the customer can choose the location and duration of the course. MOSOMIC provides also consultation services in all things related to MEMS microphones. If you're a microphone buyer, I can help you select the right components for your product and manage your microphone suppliers. I can also assist in implementing the microphones into your device. For microphone manufacturers, I provide microphone marketing, product definition, product management, and development management services. I can also help you create all kinds of MEMS microphone documentation.